You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download.
Next here, I will explore the paint node. I've made a session here specifically to do some demoing in. This is the typical setup for painting sessions. The Roto node is part of this setup as this is where the tracking is done, so it can be used with auto paint. Both nodes have a data port, which is yellow, and when they are connected, the paint node can utilize the tracking data for paint strokes across a designated frame range. All nodes have inputs or outputs or both, and depending on how they are connected, it will produce a different result. For a quick example here, you can see how the connections here facilitate auto paint, a common workflow. Up here in the Sources node, first I'm going to change the fill to transparent. That's going to give it a black alpha. And then you can see here, if I click on the Roto node, that I've already done a track on the helicopter. I'll turn on my tracking shape, and we'll do more tracking instruction later. And I'm going to turn off my tracking shape. And then here in the Paint node, I'm going to make a paint stroke to paint out the helicopter. And you can see that the data ports are connected between the Roto node and the paint node. So now I'm going to make a paint stroke, but first I'm going to make my brush larger. I'm going to press the Control Command key and just hold and drag. And then I'm going to make a paint stroke, and we'll be doing a lot more of clone painting later. So I'm in the paint node here, and I'll just make a paint stroke to paint it out. Hold down the Shift key. And there, you can see in the auto paint window here that my strokes were made. So now what are we going to do with these paint strokes? We're going to apply a track to them, but we're also going to go up to the stabilize view and choose the helicopter track. So then when we paint, we can see the paint in the stabilize view. Select our paint strokes here. We have the range set that I want. And down here in the paint tab, the transform is set to the helicopter track layer because that is where the tracking data is. And you need to make sure that match move is selected, and then you can press play. Okay, so let's see how that worked out. So that was pretty quick, and we can take the stabilization off the view to none and play through again. So you can see I have a few frames at the beginning that I have to paint out. That's where my track stopped working, but that should be pretty easy. The paint node also has several inputs here, which are referred to as sources. These are the pink bars at the top. It can pull in different paint sources, which can be selected when additional sources are hooked up and you are in the clone tool. So I have an additional source hooked up right here. And then if I go to the clone tool tab, I can select source one, and that means I am pulling from that source. So I have a little color correction on that, and I can just paint, and you can see it's darker. And I also have an offset. I can just undo that. Command Z, Control Command Z, which is common in most programs. And I can just reset and then paint again. You can see I'm just pulling through with no offset. So this is just an example of how you can pull in different sources for painting. And at the bottom of the paint node, one can output the paint along with the rest of the frame with this output on the left. Or one can choose the paint only node output, which is the pink bar in the center. This output renders only the painted portions of the frame along with an automatically generated alpha channel where the brush strokes are. It's a lighter weight file and makes it easy to composite the paint without having to do a difference mat. So let's take a look at the differences here. So here we're in the paint node, and we go to the output and we click the alpha channel. You can see that we have the full frame, the RGBA, and the paint where the alpha is. But if we switch up the connections here and we go to paint only, you can see I just have a tile where the paint is. And if I click A, you can see there's an alpha channel where the paint stroke was as well. So that makes it for quick and easy compositing. Okay, next up will be a quick demo of the brushes. So over here on the paint toolbar, each of these brushes has an assigned hotkey with its own set of parameters. And you can see the windows changing with each tool that I select. So we'll just run through these quickly. So this is the black and white tool. if I paint some strokes, it just turns the image into a monochrome image. And I'm going to go to the next frame to demo the next brush. So this is the blemish tool, which is sometimes used to correct facial blemishes. And so it combines the blur tool with some grain. So if I zoom in here, you can see it's adding some grain. I'll go to the next frame, and this is just the blur tool, which is self-explanatory. This is the detail, which kind of adds some sharpness. So it's really great if you need to pull out some more of that detail, and there's some parameters here you can change. And then this is the clone tool, and the clone tool will be in the next class. It will have its own demo, own dedicated demo. And so the next tool is the color tool. So here is where you can select colors, and there's a lot of different ways to use this brush. So for example, if I want to select a color, I can either use the color wheel, which is the hue on the outside, or the box in the middle is the brightness and the saturation. And then you can also paint with different modes. And if I end up selecting colors, I can just drag them down here into the paint pots. So if I have white selected here, I can do that. If I want to select a color, I can hold my cursor over the viewer and press the period key. And now you can see I have the blue, and I can drag that down here. If I'm over a cloud, press the period key again, and I have white, which I already have white, but I'll just pull that down here. And so that's a way to fill up your paint pots here if you want a certain range of colors to paint with. And then next up is the color correct. So I really like this tool. If I need to lighten or darken when I'm painting, I can change some values, and it's really handy. So if I want to paint something a little bit darker, I can just change the gamma here. And to see the gamma, the change, I can press the split screen here, and it's very subtle, and I can just make that a little more pronounced for this class. So now it's very dark. But if I want to paint over here, I can just, and I want to see the comparison between the original and my darker frame, my edited frame, I can just click Shift Pipe. And pipe is the key that is above the return key on the keyboard. So then it just goes to right where my cursor is. So if I'm trying to match a color or see the comparison, that's a really handy way to do that. And then we can just leave the split screen mode and the compare mode. And you can use the brush compare for most of these tools on the left. So another thing I find the color correct useful for is to painting out blue spill or green spill on edges after extractions. So you should give that a try for sure. And next is the dodge and the burn. So these tools are pretty self-explanatory. Lots of packages have them. And these are great for all sorts of painting applications. And then this is the cutout tool. I'm not going to use this in this course, so we're not going to go over it. And then we have the drag. Well, I'll just go to the next frame, which is a really handy tool for softening edges or adding motion blur. I'm using the mouse right now, but it's a little bit easier when using the Wacom pen. And then you have some ways to edit the mix with the dragging and the decay, which is the strength of the drag, the strength of the paint that you pull out. And then we have the eraser tool. And I really like this tool because if you make a mistake, instead of doing Command Z, if you've overpainted, you can actually just pull back the original frame like that. And then there's the grain tool, which I don't use a whole lot now because I'm finding myself painting on degrained frames mostly. And then there's a couple other tools that I'm not using for this course, which is the mosaic. And then we also have the repair tool. And this is an interesting tool. Let me just go up to a different part of the image here. So if I'm using this tool, the image is painted with the color level sampled at the beginning of each stroke. So I'm just going to make my brush smaller. So if I click here and I just drag out, then I have a big red stroke, but it's not quite blurring the image if I'm take the opacity down. So it's just it's not a drag tool. Is something that's a little bit different. So I think there's some, I don't use a lot, but I think there could be some really good applications for it. Another thing to know is that if you use Alt-click, you can make a straight line of the color chosen. So this might be good for painting some hard surface lines here, but we'll just do a little test here. So if I hold down Alt-Option and I'm selected on this red color, you can see there's like a little tube or a line that goes out, and it just makes a straight line of whichever color was selected. And I have my opacity a little bit lower here too. And then we have the scatter brush down here, which I don't use for painting, but it just basically just scatters the pixels. You can see here if I zoom in, it's just sort of scattering wherever my brush is. So it's kind of an artistic approach here. And then we have the strokes tool. So this strokes just shows you where all your paint strokes are. So if you want to delete a certain stroke, you can actually find it in here. If I click on that, you can see, okay, that's where the stroke was. If I don't want it, I can delete it. So there's a couple applications for using this tool. All right, well, that's the end of the very quick brush demo, and we'll have a lot more opportunity to explore these later in the course.